My name is John Motoviloff. I'm the R3 coordinator for Wisconsin for the National Wild Turkey Federation. And I'm here with my colleague Ashley Peters. And we're working on a video designed for novice hunters who want to learn how to hunt upland bird species.
I'm Ashley Peters. I'm the Director of Communications and Marketing at the Rough Grouse Society and American Woodcock Society. And I'm very excited to be here with National Wild Turkey Federation to talk more about hunting grouse and woodcock.
Both organizations have worked together in the past on young forest initiatives, which benefit both ruffed grouse and wild turkey, and a host of other game and non-game species.
Grouse and turkeys share a lot of the same habitat, albeit different age classes of forest. And so our organizations come together regularly on habitat projects, but we're also coming together today to encourage new hunters to get out in the woods and really enjoy that experience. I didn't get into hunting until a few years ago when I moved back to Minnesota and the upper Midwest, and have really enjoyed getting to know the woods around here and learning to grouse and woodcock hunt in the meantime. I also really liked the idea of being able to cook wild game, and really now I think of a trophy shot as essentially the game on the plate and my friends around me, and we're smiling for a photo and really enjoying even after the hunt. Small game has been pretty easy entry. Being able to go with friends to the trap range and get used to using a shotgun, and then really we're just taking a walk in the woods and we've got our shotguns with us, but there's no pressure to shoot, and I had friends who were very patient. So it's been a really great entry into hunting. So before I started hunting, I didn't realize how beautiful the woods were in the fall. I'd always gone to see the leaves or to go for a hike, but I hadn't really experienced the woods in the same way that I experience it now after being a hunter. And I think that's what really hooked me, was to be in the woods and be very present in that moment, and I really enjoy that. One of my first times hunting was for grouse and woodcock, and I went with a couple of friends and got to see their dogs work, which was an amazing experience that I had never had before. We also hiked through woods and had grouse flush in front of me, which is always exciting. And we got a woodcock that hunt, and it was the first time that I had really seen a woodcock up close, and they're just such incredible birds. It really hooked me and made me excited for going in the future. We're in Florence County, Wisconsin, and the habitat that you would find for grouse, woodcock, other small game is really in this area, as well as across the upper Midwest, out in the Northeast, even in Appalachia and various parts of the South. So you can really find these species across a lot of the eastern and northern parts of the U.S. When I first started hunting, one of the hardest things for me was figuring out where to scout or how to scout. So having apps like Onyx Hunt or other types of mapping programs on my phone was really important to understanding where to access different spots. It also helped to have a mentor who could show me a few spots to start with. One of my favorite types of cover to hunt in is aspen and birch, in part because of the color contrast between the whites and the bright yellows, and some days the bright blue of the sky. Rough grouse really like young forest, so if you look for areas where there have been timber harvests in recent years, that's often a really good spot to look for grouse, woodcock, and many other game species. They prefer to be in young forests that are also surrounded by different age classes of forests. You'll be finding grouse in young forest, but oftentimes there's cover nearby where they can protect themselves. And the best analogy I can think of for this is your bed being close to your refrigerator with a roof over your head. Grouse are the same. They want all the things that they need in the same little area. You're generally looking for areas where grouse can hop up on the branches and eat whatever's there at the end of the branch, whether that's fruit, nuts, catkins, any of those are appealing to them. When you harvest a grouse, one of the most interesting aspects is opening up a grouse crop, which sits at the top of their throat before it goes into their stomach. And when you open the crop, you can see all sorts of interesting things that will not only educate you about what the grouse eats, but what is in their habitat and the types of plants that are there. Woodcock are in very similar areas to grouse. A lot of times if you look for that young aspen, you'll find them there. They're looking for worms, so the more you can target moist areas, the better. Woodcock have a special bill that's really long. It looks more like a shorebird bill than it does a woodland species. Woodcock hunters often refer to woodcock poop as splash. And as you're walking through the woods, if you see a bright white spot or several of them, that's a good indicator that woodcock have been there.
It'd be a great day out there.
Hunting with a mentor is really important because it helps you understand what the regulations and safety requirements actually look like in the field. Despite what you might read in a book, there are often gray areas and things that you just don't know until you get out into the woods with somebody who knows what they're doing. Most states require hunter safety courses, which really teach you the essentials to keeping everyone safe. Regulations are really important when it comes to hunting, so it's important that you check to find out what the state you're hunting in requires. There are a lot of women-specific hunting or shooting programs that you can go to find mentors, where women who they themselves may have just recently started hunting, so they understand the process of going through and learning everything from scratch. If you hunt with a mentor, they can really help you understand the range of different guns that you might use when you're hunting different species.
Such a nice day out.
When I started hunting, I picked up a 20-gauge shotgun that a friend had given me, and we went out to the trap range, and I just tried it out and got used to handling the gun. I talked to the folks at the gun range about how to do that, what was safe, and over time, it just became habit for me to do those safe practices. So I really recommend that if you're looking to getting into hunting, you go to a gun range, you get used to your gun before you ever get out in the field. To get started in upland hunting, you really can just go for the basics. So you can have a vest that's maybe blaze orange if that's required in the state where you're hunting, and a pair of boots, and a gun that you've acquired, as well as safety gear like eye protection and ear protection. When you think of what other types of gear you would have in the field, it's really very similar to if you were going on a very long hike in an area where you're maybe unfamiliar with the territory. Before starting to grouse and woodcock hunt, I had never seen a dog work in the woods. And when I went out with friends and got to see the dog on point, and the dog get really excited when you take shots and retrieve the bird, it was such an incredible thing to see the partnership between the dog and the owner, and really understanding how hunting is essential for a lot of people. It is the place that they feel most alive, and it's where their dogs feel most alive. I always recommend that folks go out with someone who does have a dog and someone who doesn't have a dog, so that you get to see the differences between how you hunt the woods if you've got a dog by your side versus if you're just hunting on your own or with a partner. If you're just starting out and you don't have a dog, that is totally okay. There are plenty of ways to hunt for upland birds without having a dog. Well, a lot of people recommend that you take several steps forward and then stop. That will sometimes unnerve the birds, and then they will naturally flush as you do that.
I think it went down!
Hunting small game and upland birds is one of the most incredible ways that you can spend a fall. You'll be out in beautiful landscape. If you're lucky, you'll be alongside some really good friends, and you might even get to take some dinner home with you.
Okay.
Another one in the bag.
Yeah, great.
Thank you.
I never really know if I'm gonna take a grouse, woodcock, squirrel, or rabbit home. There's always the potential that I could leave the woods empty-handed. But honestly, that's okay, because I usually have a really good day in the field, I get to spend some time with friends, and often you're in some of the most beautiful landscapes. If you're thinking about getting into upland birds, especially in forested places, I encourage you to be really patient with yourself. Sometimes it takes a while to learn these skills, but if you have good mentors, good friends, good shooting range, you really will have all the resources at your disposal to become a good hunter. And at the end of the day, it doesn't matter whether or not you bring something out of the woods with you, because if you've had a good day, if you've had a good experience, that's all that really matters. If I had one thing to say to a new hunter, I would say, find a good mentor and be patient with yourself. Those are the two biggest things that got me into hunting and kept me hunting. And now I'm excited to be a mentor because it means I can introduce people to this thing I love. And also folks can learn more about how this ties into a larger conservation landscape and how we can conserve these resources for the future.